Here we go. It is the grand final Masters Division. Palafin, Baxcalibur on the field for Gabriella Garcia. Palafin on the opposing side for Paul, but paired up with the Fluttermane.
All right, so we got the Palafins hitting the field right away for both of our trainers, identifying that this is going to be a powerhouse Pokemon that they can rely upon. And now this really does put them into a position where they can start to pivot these Palafin off of the field and start to play that mind game of, okay, do I actually switch it out or do I try to keep it on the field to start getting those punches in?
That's the thing, the Baxcalibur is the Pokemon though with the target on its back. Paul already identified it's a difficult Pokemon that you can't always hit for good damage, so needs to be able to get an early knockout. Gabrielle switching the Palafin off the field in favor of that Amoongus that's going to be able to apply some spore pressure in the following turns. A Palafin apiece leaving the field. We're going to see them come back both with heroic transformations later on in the match.
That's going to be a really pivotal thing to have in your back pocket, just knowing that you do have that extra amplified damage at your disposal. But knowing that the Arcanine is switching in here, this is one of the ways that Paul can start to try to keep this Baxcalibur in check when it comes down to its attacking moves, because the Baxcalibur does have that clear amulet item that Adam and Lee were talking about earlier, and that will not allow for this Intimidate drop to drop this Baxcalibur's attack stat.
And to add insult to injury, it's gone for the Poison Terra type, which means it isn't going to be able to resist those Fairy type attacks. Gets a cheeky critical hit on the opposing Amoongus, however, but Baxcalibur able to fire off a powerful Icicle Crash that will do so much damage to that Fluttermane. It's now in a very dangerous position. It's a very heavy hitter for Paul, so you might want to try and switch it out, preserve it for later on in the match.
Yep. You can see that Paul's trying to hover over how to try to keep this Baxcalibur in check. You did have the Baxcalibur go for the Terra Poison, and so that's one way that you really saw allow that Baxcalibur to take that Dazzling Gleam so effectively.
The defensive Terra types have been strong. Amoongus actually getting out of the way here, because even though it's gonna resist the Fairy type attacks that the Fluttermane is locked into, it doesn't want to take an unnecessary Flare Blitz from that Arcanine. Intimidate will come onto the field. That's only really gonna bother the Arcanine on Paul's side. No clear amulets to be found here. It's holding those safety goggles instead. You can see how little these Fairy type moves are doing though.
Yes, that's not gonna be just a little bit of chip damage there, and the Flare Blitz on top of that as well for the Arcanine switch in that Gabrielle brought in is going to take that handedly as well. Glaive Rush, that's going to do a significant chunk of damage there to the Arcanine.
This could be the opening Paul needs, though. After Glaive Rush, you know, moves are guaranteed to hit. It's going to be dealing double damage, and that's where we often see Pokemon like Baxcalibur protecting on this turn. And that's where the mind games come into effect. The protect may be obvious, so you could ignore the Baxcalibur, maybe double down into the partner slot. But then if you're Gabrielle and you want to play boldly, you could always go for a move here, thinking that your opponent's going to protect that protect.
Yeah, that's definitely something that Paul's going to have to navigate around, as you do see just a switch here that Fluttermane now going to retreat back into its Pokeball, reset the choice specs for a little bit later, and the Palafin now to take that Pokemon's place.
Yeah, Palafin here to play. We're going to see the Arcanine leave the field on Gabrielle's side of the field, and the Arcanine on Paul's side in a difficult spot because it really cannot do too much to that opposing Baxcalibur, particularly because of its thermal exchange, not going to be able to be hit by any of those Fire-type moves.
Yeah, you are going to see the Protect come through here, though, in the Ice Shard, just to try to whittle away at the Fluttermane that was right there. But the Palafin taking that super nicely, and also setting itself up to be able to deal some nice damage across the board as well. Maybe not looking at something like the Amoongus as being the particularly great target here, so something like a Rage Powder would be able to redirect away a super effective attack like that. But you are looking at maybe another pivot here, as you still have some tools available for both sides.
Yeah, I think the Ice Shard might even have been able to get the KO on the Fluttermane, so a really nice adjustment by Paul. Not only do you preserve that Fluttermane that's often nice and speedy in the back for later, you've now got the Palafin on the field that can apply that pressure. Maybe something like a Wave Crash to deal some huge damage here. It's still got a lot of HP remaining. Might be able to take a Glaive Rush if that is the intended target.
Yep. You're going to see the Arcanine now switch out. Just try to preserve that Intimidate for later if it's worried about the Palafin. But here's the Fluttermane to take its place.
Back so soon, Fluttermane joining us in the finals, and Palafin just going for the Protect, trying to see what strategy Gabrielle wants to go for here. It was indeed the Glaive Rush going down into that slot, so really nice defensive play from Paul. The Amoongus, however, is primed to go for the Spore, and it catches the Fluttermane on the switch in.
Here you go, so Fluttermane is going to go right to sleep here, and that is not something that Paul wanted to see, as that Fluttermane could have been able to put on just a little bit more pressure here, but now it looks like a nice target, either to be able to get knocked out this turn or for something else to switch into its place.
Yeah, the Fluttermane in a difficult situation because it doesn't want to go for any of these Fairy-type moves, the Moonblast or the Dazzling Gleam, when you've got two Poison-types opposing you on the field. Maybe a safer choice would be to lock in with something like that Shadow Ball, still deal a huge chunk of damage, particularly as you are rocking those choice specs. The alternative thing, however, is to switch out, because you're gonna have to take a turn of sleep. You're very vulnerable on the field at this point in time, and that really does make the Fluttermane null and void for Paul here.
Oh, it's going to be a double switch on both sides as the Fluttermane leaves the field in favor of the Amoongus for Paul. And Gabriel now bringing out his very own Palafin with that heroic transformation.
Look at that. Two Palafins, two Amoonguses on the field. Wavecrash will go down into the opposing Palafin, does about a third of damage. I'm going to, of course, take a little bit of recoil here. Amoongus on Gabriel's side is able to get the spore down on the Palafin.
This is really, really risky here, and Gabriel knows that this Amoongus is in such an awkward position now that he has dropped the Protect for the Clear Smog. So Amoongus is always going to be trying to go for some type of utility in this matchup, and this time it's been able to land its second Spore. That's going to put Paul into a very difficult position moving forward, knowing that both the Fluttermane and the Palafin have to take a mandatory turn of sleep, and that's allowing for the setup here of the Substitute.
Gabriel capitalizing on this, a fantastic adjustment, putting the Substitute onto the Palafin, particularly when you have your trusted partner with the Amoongus, not only being able to put Pokemon on the opposing side to sleep, but being able to go for a cheeky Pollen Puff to the side to regain that HP that you lost by setting up the Substitute. You can see Amoongus doing the exact same thing on Paul's side. That's really one of the benefits to having this partner Pokemon.
Yeah, the Pollen Puff is going to be so important here to be able to keep their partner Pokemon healthy as they look to try to wake up this turn. Paul's Palafin has just taken its mandatory turn of sleep, but it still has another hurdle to get over in the Substitute that Gabriel's Palafin set up.
That's the thing, and behind that Substitute, the Palafin can come out and still deal a huge chunk of damage. You have to be able to find a way to not only break the Substitute, but then be able to get a knockout before it's able to run rampant on the field. You can see it moving first here, Wavecrash into the opposing Palafin, only does about a third of damage, and we're now in this interesting situation where the Palafins really can't do too much to each other, and you've got the Amoonguses on the field where they can just heal up with a Pollen Puff. So yes, Paul's Palafin here isn't able to move. It's gonna have to take some double damage, but you can see it's just below 50%, and that's where Amoongus can maybe help out, but the Pollen Puff actually going down into the opposing Palafin here, trying to get a break, but it's not enough, Rosemary.
No, it's not. That Substitute's gonna keep that Palafin on Gabriel's side nice and safe, as we saw. Pollen Puff also traded towards the way of Paltua's Palafin there, so it's just about to try to whittle away at these hyper-offensive threats on the field as Paul's Palafin wakes up for the Jet Punch. May not be very effective, and the Substitute is going to take that damage, but it does get the Substitute to go away.
That'll do it, getting the quick Jet Punch in as the Palafin on the opposing side is able to actually go for the Wave Crash and get the knockout. So yes, Jet Punch having that priority, but not enough to do big, big damage, particularly when you're only breaking that Substitute. So a really nice KO here for Gabriella Gotti.
Really nice KO and a really nice cherry on top as you see the Pollen Puff there from the Amoongus being able to heal up for all of that residual damage there. But it's time for Paul's turn to put some Pokemon to sleep. And so Gabriel's Palafin, after a job well done, will take a short nap.
That's really the trade-off here. You do lose your Palafin, but you do enable it to get out from behind that Substitute and leave itself exposed to take something like the Spore. Speaking of sleeping Pokemon, however, the Fluttermane has rejoined the field here for Paul, and I think it still has to take its first mandatory turn.
It does. It did not get to be able to do that before it ended up leaving the field. So that is a little bit of breathing room here for Gabriel to start to pivot things around. Amoongus now going to leave the field, get a little bit of HP recovery thanks to that Regenerator ability, and now Arcanine taking its place.
I really like this switch in here. The Intimidate's not really the valid point. It's the fact that you've got an Arcanine that's going to be able to potentially resist those Fairy-type moves coming out from the Fluttermane and apply great pressure to this pesky Amoongus that's just putting Pokemon to sleep. You've got the Amoongus going for the Pollen Puff onto the side here of that Fluttermane, giving it a little bit more breathing room with HP recovery.
Yeah, you do have that, and so that's going to feel really nice to allow that Fluttermane to be able to wake up just a little bit later. But another nice reason to have this Arcanine switch in here is that the Arcanine is carrying the safety goggles. So not only can it not be redirected away with a Rage Powder there from the Amoongus, but it also can't be put to sleep.
I think Amoongus's job, though, here is actually to sit on the field, allow Paul to rotate Pokemon in and get a cheeky Pollen Puff to the side to regain HP. The Flare Blitz from the Arcanine on the opposing side goes into the opposing Arcanine, not going to deal too much damage, take a little bit of recoil, but my eyes really are on Amoongus, seeing if it is maybe going to give a little bit of HP recovery to that Arcanine, while Palafin in this Grand Finals is still taking a turn of sleep.
I mean, what a comeback that Paul has been able to make there with the HP recovery gifted over from the Pollen Puff Amoongus. Really feels like Paul has set himself up to have a better end game now that the Fluttermane has the opportunity to wake up, and there's a lot more pivot potential here because Paul's Amoongus is still very full HP.
The issue with the waking up, though, is that Palafin's sleep turns are ticking along, and it's going to be able to get a solid KO with Wave Crash into that opposing Arcanine here and still deal some good damage to that opposing Amoongus. And it's been so disruptive. You know, if you're Gabrielle now, you want to try and get it off the field and then allow possibly your Bug to come back in and try and get some good knockouts. We have got the Fluttermane rejoining. It's still sleeping here. As Arcanine goes for that Howl, love to see this. Not only will it give itself an attack boost, but the sleeping Palafin will get one as well. So when it wakes up, it is ready for action.
Well, it's going to take another turn of sleep right now, but it is at least going to start to prep itself, absolutely. As you see another Pollen Puff here from Paul into that partner Fluttermane to be able to bring it back up to full HP. But the Howl, I mean, that just negated the Intimidate drop that came through, and maybe that'll force Paul into a position where he feels he needs to cycle that in again.
Exactly, and I really love how this Fluttermane has been able to truly get its beauty sleep here, because it left the field with such low HP, but being able to take two Pollen Puffs to get that HP recovery puts it back in the position it really was at the beginning of the game. It just needs to wake up in order for Paul to be able to swing some momentum in his direction. Amoongus is going to join the field for Gabrielle here.
All right, well, we're going to see a Rage Powder to be able to draw the attention away from the Fluttermane in case it does get the wake up here. But it is going to remain asleep for this particular turn. But the Palafin has Dawn taking its turns of sleep. It's going to go for the Wave Crash into the Amoongus. And even though it's not very effective, it's still going to be able to do a bit of damage there.
It's starting to apply pressure to that Amoongus. And, you know, if you're not careful on Paul's side, it's going to be knocked out. And then you're going to be in this awkward situation where you only really have your offensive Pokemon left. That supportive role will be knocked out. And that will allow Gabrielle to start building up some momentum. You have to watch out for this Palafin, though, because it can certainly still hit hard. Possibly try and use the Amoongus to put it to sleep again.
Maybe. I think you have to try to go for something to be able to keep it in check. And one of those ways is definitely get the Intimidate cycle in here to be able to drop the Palafin's attack that was negated by the Howl we saw a few turns ago. But it's not going to be able to redirect away the fact that you've got the Wave Crash here if you're not going to go for that. And so the Wave Crash into the Arcanine is a big knockout here to bring Paul down to his final two Pokemon.
Intimidate or not, there's a reason why Palafin can win these internationals. The Spore going down into the opposing Amoongus, obviously not going to be able to affect it, but the Spore onto the Palafin will put it to sleep. But I think getting that critical knockout obviously now does give Gabrielle the Pokemon advantage.
Really does in this position, especially when you look at that Fluttermane being that final Pokemon in the back. It still has yet to wake up. And you are also looking at the Amoongus just having a little bit too much to be able to get through. So you can see that Paul there is going to hover over the forfeit for this game number one. So a Gabrielle Agati in this best of three goes up one game.
Once again, Firewater Grass Core absolutely taking names. We were really hyping up that back Excalibur, and it came out with such offensive pressure, forcing Paul to react to it very early on in that game one. It went for that Poison Terror, really nice defensive strategy that made it even harder then for Paul to be able to break through it. The thing I loved most about this game one, however, is Gabrielle identified that the Backscalibur is a problem, but it's not the only issue that Paul has to deal with in his team. Backscalibur went into the back, and that constant rotation of the Firewater Grass Core meant that Paul was constantly having to play Gabrielle's game and not being able to get his momentum up.
Yeah, and I think that's something that's really unique about this particular matchup is not only do they both have intelligence about how this matchup played out previously when they played each other in that Swiss round number 12. Gabrielle did get that win in that match and ended up snapping Paul Chua's undefeated streak up until that point. But Paul also identifies how strong Backscalibur is because, as you mentioned, Lou, this is the same six that Gabrielle is using that Paul used for that top 16 in Fort Wayne. So we need to see some adjustments here.
We seem to have had a tidal wave of these rematches coming up through Swiss across the broadcast the entire weekend, and it's lovely to be able to have it here in the finals and possibly get some redemption for Paul, but it's going to be a hard hill to climb. In game two here, again, Palafin a piece on both sides. That Backscalibur out front and center for Gabrielle with Paul having that Fluttermane once again applying pressure. I wonder if we're going to see another Terra Poison here.
It makes a lot of sense knowing that you are looking down a Fluttermane here and the same leads in game number one, but it's about the adjustments on what happens on this first turn that can really change the tide here and maybe get Paul a win to be able to tie up this series. The first adjustment is that we will see a switch on Paul's side to kick off the second game, and it's going to be the Arcanine to come back onto the field.
Yep, once again, getting that Palafin out nice and early so we can go through its zero to hero transformation later on, and the Palafin matching the same strategy on Gabrielle's side of the field. I think it's interesting as well, we obviously get a sneak peek into what Paul is bringing. It's the same full Pokemon here, so trusting them to be able to try and carry this through to push for a game three.
Right, well, we are going to see a Terrastalization once again onto the Baxcalibur to make it a Terra Poison type right away. What a strong strategy for Gabriel in that game number one. And so he's going to run it back here.
I honestly see no reason to do anything else at this point. It gives the Baxcalibur so much safety coverage, but the Fluttermane not playing into it, going for that Shadow Ball instead of the Fairy Time move. Not quite enough to make it a two-hit knockout. Oh. And we are going to see an avoid.
Yeah, that Icicle Crash from the Baxcalibur not going to find its mark this time, and that relieves so much pressure off of Paul's side so early on. Beforehand, you saw how much damage that Fluttermane took on that very first turn, and you also were able to dish out more damage in return because you chose the Shadow Ball instead.
Exactly, and that's unfortunate. There have been nice damage on the board there for Gabriel. Of course, the Arcanine in a position to threaten down against that opposing Amoongus, and I really like the way Gabriel is playing this, actually saying, you know what, I'm going to preserve that Baxcalibur once again. You really don't have a way to deal with it, so possibly in the end game, it's a nice way to clean up, and Arcanine's going to come out and throw down and intimidate against the opposing Arcanine, maybe buy that Amoongus a bit of breathing room. It's first of all going to have to take another Choice Spec Shadow Ball here. Again, not quite enough to be able to get a two-hit knockout against it.
No, it's not, but the Flare Blitz to follow it up sure will be enough on top. And so the first KO of game number two going to Paul. Amoongus off the board here for Gabriel.
Nice and early doors getting that KO on the board, and I think the double up was a really nice play. Knowing the Shadow Ball wasn't quite going to be enough, but that's why you have your Arcanine there to help out and go for a powerful Flare Blitz. This now does give a little bit of an issue to Gabriel here. You don't necessarily have the momentum to switch in that Amoongus, start putting Pokemon to sleep, and I think critically using that Pollen Puff. Both the Amoonguses on these trainers' teams have been so critical in that supportive role, and I think looking at how their speed interactions are going, it's going to be interesting as well, because not only are you trying to put Pokemon to sleep, you're trying to heal your Pokemon before they take damage.
Absolutely, and that's something that both of these trainers are really trying to be cognizant of, not only do how the Fluttermanes could match up, but really the Amoonguses and the Arcanines this time around, really what is available to be able to try to grab that edge. We are going to see Gabriel bring the Palafin back out onto the field, undergoing its transformation and applying a lot of pressure here now with something like a Jet Punch or that Wave Crash.
That's the thing, you can just switch the Arcanine out here though, use it to intimidate that opposing Palafin later on in the match, and it gives you the perfect opportunity to bring that Amoongus in. It's going to be able to take those water type moves really, really well, and you want to try and put that opposing Palafin to sleep just like Paul did in game number one.
Well, you're going to see a Protect here from Gabriel's side to be able to protect it from that Shadow Ball. Of course, amplified by the Choice Specs, but the Flare Blitz here into the Fluttermane. Nice damage down onto that Pokemon.
Yeah, really, really nice to see this Arcanine going straight onto the offensive, just trying to get rid of this Fluttermane. Paul, using it to great effect, though. Those Shadow Balls are certainly still applying a lot of pressure.
Yeah, it's a great move choice to lock into as well, and despite the fact that you know that the Baxcalibur is off the field for now, it's allowing this Fluttermane to just stay on the field and try to keep pressuring down damage. You're basically taking a Pokemon to roughly half, and that softens it up enough that something else that Paul could be switching into the field would be able to secure the knockout after that.
Exactly, that's why they call it a team at the end of the day. You need to be able to go for those double ups to try and get the KOs, and it's nice to see Fluttermane actually in action. It slept for most of game one, but it's now woke up and ready for the battle. The Intimidate, I think, here is really nice from Paul, just being able to weaken the offensive pressure on Gabriel's side of the field. But we know that there is potentially a Howl from that Arcanine that can bring that right back up. The Shadow Ball, again, just doing a good amount of damage to the opposing Palafin. And there it is, the Howl coming out from this Arcanine, boosting the attack back out and really negating that Intimidate.
Yeah, I mean, Palafin's still going to take quite a bit of damage here, but it is able to get this substitute up. We saw that be a tremendous strategy that Gabriel could use in that game number one, but it's at such limited HP, and that Amoongus is off the field now, so no way to recover any of that HP with Pollen Puff.
That's a great observation, and it's really the difference between games one and two. The extreme speed going down into that Palafin, just trying to leave it exposed for this Fluttermane to get the KO, but it's not. It's staying behind a substitute. Jet Punch will be able to get the KO into that opposing Fluttermane here, and Palafin safe and sound behind the substitute at the end of this game, despite the efforts from that Arcanine. And I do really like that play. If you're able to leave it exposed, it makes it easier in that next turn. Flare Blitz really not doing too much here, but maybe covering for a potential switch.
Yeah, well, especially when you did get the Howl boost as well to the attack, then it's really nice just to be able to try to land as much chip as possible. But the sub being able to survive through that extreme speed is huge, because you're saving that Pokemon for another turn here when you're looking at also how do these Palafins match up against each other.
And this is the temptation, right? You want to go for another extreme speed to try and break that substitute, but the issue is the Arcanine's then very vulnerable to a potential Jet Punch coming out from that Palafin. Even if you break the substitute, it's not like you deal any additional damage to it and is going to be able to move fast. Arcanine on Gabrielle's side, though, just going for a Protect, knowing that it, too, could fall victim to a Water-type move from the Palafin on the opposing side. There's the Extreme Speed, Rosemary.
Well, this is a big turn, because was that Protect worth it in the end, as we do see Palafin's substitute fade away, leaving Gabrielle's Palafin exposed, as you see the Jet Punch into the opposing Arcanine there. So Paul missing the mark on that side of things, but the Wave Crash in response. Gabrielle's Palafin getting a chance to move just to be able to do a bit of damage.
Yes, and I think the Arcanine on Paul's side got away a little lightly here, you know, not taking the damage from the opposing Palafin, actually, on Gabrielle's side, choosing to try and target down into Paul's. This is where things get interesting, though, because there is still a terrestrialization potential on Paul's side, and it could give that Arcanine the breathing room that it needs with a defensive Terra type.
And it didn't get a chance to actually terrestrialize in that game number one. Paul never found an opportunity or found a way to be able to weave in terrestrialization to be an asset for the team. So this time around, it is time to terrestrialize, and that Palafin is about to be putting out a ton of damage.
Here we go. It's going for the Terra Water on the Palafin side here, so it's going to be able to pack a really, really heavy punch, try and get the knockouts and clean up this game too.
See how this all plays out here as we see a Protect come through from Gabrielle's Palafin first, just in the face of some oncoming damage. The extreme speed there from Paul's Arcanine, not able to find its mark into the Palafin to clean up the KO. But the Jet Punch in response, Gabrielle's Arcanine is quite exposed here, and that's gonna be a knockout.
Yeah, I think Gabrielle kind of slowing the pace down here with that Protect, and Paul being able to capitalize on it and go straight onto the offensive, getting that critical knockout. That means there's no more Arcanine on Gabrielle's side that's gonna be able to throw Intimidates down against the offensive powerhouses on Paul's side. The issue, of course, is still that Baxcalibur. The one nice thing is that Shadow Ball from earlier has put it in a little bit more of a vulnerable position. We see the cancel here. It looks like we are going to a game three.
Game three upon us. Both of our trainers in this Masters Division Finals are at one win apiece. So this next game is going to decide it all to see who is going to become your EUIC 2023 champion. And they are both making such strong cases for themselves so far, where I feel like as well, when you look at Paul's side of the field, we didn't get a chance to talk about the difference in the Arcanines just yet. But because we saw Howl come out from Gabrielle's, the biggest change is that Paul's doesn't have that. It has access to the priority attack extreme speed, which is one that we've seen be a little bit more popular on Arcanine builds as of late, and I feel like Paul found himself in a position in that game too where he was really able to take advantage of those priority attacks.
I think that's a great observation as well, because both the Howl and the Extreme Speed have been critical in that game too. We saw both the Arcanines using them to great effect and for that purpose. Howl obviously being kind of the newer tech that trainers have opted for in order to kind of counter all the Intimidates running around, because it's not just Arcanine you have to prep for nowadays, it's the Gyarados as well that we've seen rising in popularity. So I think it's a really nice option, because not only does it negate the Intimidate on your Pokemon that's using it, but the partner Pokemon too. And with the amount of physical attackers that are running around, you can often have both those Pokemon in the right ball position in order to get that boost.
Well, our trainers are locked in, ready to go for this game number three here at the 2023 European International Championships. And it's going to be a run back of the leads that we saw for games one and two to decide it all.
One game separates these players between victory and runner-up status. Let's see what they're going to be going in for. I think this is the game where you need to go straight onto the offensive. Possibly with these Palafins, we've seen them switching out in order to go through that zero to hero transformation. But Palafin, even in its zero form, if it is going for something like a terrestrialization, getting that extra boost to his water type moves, can still do a big chunk of damage on the field.
Yeah, it's going to be an early terrestrialization right away, so huge mix-up here from games one and two, as we see the baby Palafin, our Palafin in that zero form, getting the Terra to be able to deal some devastating damage.
I love to see the change of pace. Paula switched that Palafin out very early on in games one and two, but this time switching onto the offensive. But look, there's going to be a terrestrialization on Gabrielle's side as well. It is that Baxcalibur with the poison defensive typing once again.
So terrestrialization off the board for both of our trainers incredibly early in this last game. That was been the saving grace here for Gabrielle's side with the Terra Poison, but Paul is not going to fall for it again. And so the Shadow Ball right into that Baxcalibur and a Wave Crash to be able to follow it up.
That pesky Baxcalibur has been felled by the double up from Paul Chua. A sigh of relief getting rid of that Pokemon that he knew was going to be the thorn in his side.
No need to play around that clear amulet anymore. And you can see that our trainers are looking at how this next few turns of this match are going to shape out here. here as Gabriel does get a chance to get a free switch in for the Palafin of his own that did get the transformation.
Yes, these trainers certainly do mean business in this game three, and it's nice to see the Palafin coming in for Gabriel here. It can apply a lot of pressure, of course, to that opposing Fluttermane, and I see no surprises why it's then leaving the field. You want to maybe go and lock in for a different move into later turns. We're going to see the Arcanine join perfect time because there's a physical attacker on the opposing side of the field. Plus, the safety goggles means that it cannot be put to sleep by that opposing Amoongus.
Yes, an excellent choice here for Paul. In fact, we'll see a double switch to get his own Palafin off the field. Make sure that it can come back in nice and strong as well, as it will be an Amoongus as the fourth and final revealed here for Paul, as the wave crash into the Arcanine is just going to be a one and knockout with the critical hit.
Oh my goodness, the Arcanine sitting so vulnerable. A really bold play from Paul, but unfortunately it just didn't pay off, losing the Arcanine very early doors, and the Palafin able to get a cheeky Pollen Puff to regain that HP that it lost earlier.
So it feels like it got away with that scot-free, yeah, knowing that it had that HP recovery available. And now Paul has to switch back into this Fluttermane that left the field so early on in the game.
It may be the early riser, but that Fluttermane is in a difficult spot because it cannot protect. It is going to be vulnerable to something like a Spore if Paul wants to leave it on the field. And then it's going to be in a difficult spot where it needs to be able to wake up, deal some big damage, and not do what happened in game one and fall asleep.
I think this is a really smart play here by Gabriel because, yeah, you are locked into having to take some damage here, but like you know that the Fluttermane can't protect, you know that Gabriel's can't either. So it will have to take a Shadow Ball here, but in response, it does land a Spore onto Paul's Fluttermane.
Yes, and now the Fluttermane very vulnerable to that Palafin in the next turn. We can see the double up into Amoongus takes it below 50%. Of course, it's going to activate the berry, so the Amoongus can't utilize that going forward. But I really do think Gabriel has all the kind of cards on the table here. You're able to apply a lot of damage with that Palafin. There's nothing the Fluttermane can do. It's going to have to take a turn of sleep here. And then even if you switch something like a Palafin in from the back, you have to watch out from a potential Spore on the Amoongus going into that slot, predicting maybe the switch.
Yes, I mean, this is all about a game of reading at this point because these players are so familiar with these teams and they are familiar with each other's play style. So we will see the Amoongus now leave the field for Gabriel in favor of that Arcanine.
You know, I really like this. Arcanine can get in really safely at this point in time. The Fluttermane is going to stay on the field, take its one guaranteed turn of sleep as Palafin capitalizes on this and goes for the substitute. This obviously keeps it safe from any spores as well that Amoongus would want to throw into its side. It's going to be the Pollen Puff, however, just trying to break that substitute, but we know Amoongus is not the most offensive Pokemon here, but it does manage to do it. I'm sorry, Amoongus.
Yeah, I think you got to take that back, Lou.
My bad.
Amoongus said, I've got a critical hit Pollen Puff for you, which was plenty to be able to break the substitute. And so just like that, the setup has been removed from the field and that defensive style of play is just not available. Gabriel might want to try to go for it again, but that Palafin is sitting quite vulnerable in the face of this Fluttermane that could wake up this turn.
That's the thing, the guaranteed turn of sleep has already happened. So you now are looking towards that Fluttermane if you're Paul and hoping it's going to be able to wake up and try and get some big damage with a Shadow Ball out onto the side of the field. You have to contend though as well the fact that Gabriel not only has the Palafin in play, but it has that partner Pokemon as well that can, with the Arcanine, apply a lot of pressure to the opposing Amoongus. But not in this turn, it is going to retreat.
It's going to be another rotation here as we see the Arcanine leave the field in favor of the Amoongus, and the Fluttermane does get the wake up, goes for the Shadow Ball right into Gabriel's Palafin, and it is going to be able to hang on, but it negates the ability for the Palafin to make a substitute. So it's just going to go right to sleep.
Everything going perfectly for Paul here. Just puts it over the edge to stop the substitute from being activated on Gabriel's side of the field. To add insult to injury, the Spore follows up. Palafin is taking a nap in this game three. This is not the time.
This is definitely not the time because this is where the stakes are highest. And Paul being able to get that wake up means that he is inching ever closer to claiming an international championship title. But how can Gabriel bring it back? Forced to leave the field with the Palafin, knowing that the Fluttermane is going to be one of the fastest things on the field and is trying to look for an opportunity to reposition his board so that maybe he can get some HP recovery later or at least try to take out this Fluttermane.
Yes, I mean, on Gabriel's side of the field, your Arcanine and Amoongus are relatively healthy at this point in time. You know that the Fluttermane is locked into that Shadow Ball and it's not going to be able to get a knockout on either of them. So possibly could enable one of Gabriel's Pokemon to pick up the KO against the Fluttermane in this turn. The Shadow Ball going down as the Arcanine does over 50% to it, and the Amoongus able to follow up with a Spore and catch the Palafin on the switch in here. Really, really nice play, but the issue is that Fluttermane is still unchecked.
Yeah, but I think you're okay with that. Amoongus could be able to redirect away an attack here, maybe give your Arcanine an opportunity. And the fact that you were able to catch that read with the Palafin switch in is absolutely huge, giving Gabriel another chance in this game.
All eyes really on that Amoongus. The Fluttermane's not going into the Arcanine. Instead, it's the Amoongus. It's going to do over 50% to it. Of course, able to take that really well. But the Amoongus has the utility here to either go for a Pollen Puff into the opposing Fluttermane or a Spore. And I think, quite wise, just trying to put it to sleep, guarantee that it is going to have to take another turn. You then, of course, have the Amoongus capable of either going for a Pollen Puff into the Arcanine. But if you don't want to run the risk of that Palafin waking up, you can always go for that redirection.
Well, you're going to see the pivot now. This is Gabriel's chance to be able to get the Palafin back in and land something like a Pollen Puff onto it to be able to restore up all the HP that it has lost so far. And with Fluttermane taking a turn of sleep, this is really where we see the Palafin now! Maybe getting the Palawin here for Paul as it's able to go for the Wave Crash and it lands it into the Amoongus, getting the knockout!
That was the perfect moment to wake up. Palafin takes the KO against the opposing Amoongus and really does put Paul in a very commanding fashion here. Of course, if you're Gabrielle, you now have the utility to bring your Arcanine in from the back. You only have two remaining Pokemon. You are going to be able to intimidate the Palafin, but you have no way to do any kind of defensive terrors. That's already gone on your back, Excalibur. Palafin in a very, very strong position to get another knockout here.
It's going to still have to see if it can wake up here, but I think Gabrielle knows this is it. The battle is over, and Paul Chua becomes your 2023 European International Champion.
Huge congratulations several years on after that second place finish on the international stage. He's done it. He is the champion here in London at the European International Championships.